How's that? Woo! That's it. Okay. Okay. Turn to Genesis 22. Genesis 22. I shared some of this in our Sunday school class, and it's just been building. And we hardly remember what we preached last Sunday anyway, so it's good to go over some of these things. But the mountain Moriah has just been going through my mind and my heart, and I've been studying that and what happened on Mount Moriah, but not only on Mount Moriah, but Mount Olive and also Mount Zion. And the picture that I want you to see is, when we say a mountain, we're not talking about a big mountain. You got to look way up there, you know. But a mount, high, it's a mount. And so you've got Mount Olive, you've got Mount Zion, and you've got Mount Moriah, okay? And we're going to talk a little bit about those three mounts. But I want you to picture around that mountain, those mountains, you can go 50 miles in diameter, however, which way you want to go. But there's so much that has happened around that particular area of Jerusalem. Now remember, Jerusalem is on Mount Moriah. It's also called Mount Zion. So we want to talk a little bit about that. And first thing that I want to share with you, though, is about Abraham and Isaac. And this is in chapter 22, starting verse 1. After these events, God tested and proved Abraham and said to him, Abraham, and he said, here I am. Verse 2, you put that on the board up there. He's got it on the board. Verse 2, God said, take now your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the region of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering upon one of the mountains. Notice one of the mountains, and the other two mountains there, of course, Mount Zion and Mount, Olive. I lost my place, I'll find it. And offer him there as a burnt offering upon one of the mountains of which I will tell you. So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him, which was his servants, and his son Isaac, and he split the wood for the burnt offering, and then began the trip to the place of which God had told him. At this particular time, Abraham was living at Beersheba. And Mount Moriah is about 50 miles going north of Beersheba. When I say Mount Moriah, just think of Jerusalem up there. And so Beersheba, they live there. They travel 3 miles. It took them 3 days to get to Mount Moriah. Now, this is before, this is way back there now, 4,000 years ago. And so Jerusalem wasn't there at that particular point. But anyway, on the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place in the distance. So they traveled for 3 days. He looks up and he sees the distance. He sees Mount Moriah where God told him to go. And Abraham said to his servant, settle down and stay here with the donkey, and I and the young man will go yonder and worship and come again to you. Notice that. Verse 6 is the next one. You following me? Verse 6, okay. Then Abraham took the wood for the burnt offering and laid it on the shoulders of Isaac, his son, and he took the fire and the fire pot in his own hand and a knife, and the two of them went on together. And Isaac said to Abraham, my father. And he said, here I am, my son. Verse 7. Isaac said, see, here are the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering or burnt sacrifice? Verse 8. Abraham said, my son, God himself will provide a lamb for the burnt offering. So the two went on together. Verse 9. And when they came to the place of which God had told him, Abraham built an altar there. Then he laid the wood in order and bound Isaac, his son, and laid him on the altar of the wood. Verse 10. And Abraham stretched forth his hand and took hold of the knife to slay his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. He answered, Here I am. Verse 12. And he said, Do not lay your hand on the lad or do anything to him, for now I know that you fear and reverence God, since you have not held back from me or begrudged given me your son, your only son. Let's stop there for a moment, and I want you to see the picture. They're living in Bathsheba. God speaks to Abraham, and he obeys. You don't see any grumbling or any complaining. He doesn't even tell Sarah, because how many know that would have probably been a big fight? Did I hear you correctly, Abraham? You're going to take who? My son? Your son? You're going to do what now? You're going to take him where? You're going to do what with him? Offer him up as a what? Are you kidding? How many of you know there would have been a big fight there? How many women understand that? Yeah. You're not taking my son on that mount and offering him. But you don't see none of that. He just moves. He just obeys God. And it took him 3 days to get there. He had his two servants with him. They had the donkey, which probably carried the wood. So they reached a certain place, and the two servants and the donkey stayed there. And he went ahead and took the wood and gave it to Isaac. And Isaac and Abraham went further up on the mountain. And when they got to the top there, they built an altar. Okay, and we see the picture there. Now, that's a picture of Jesus Christ. Isaac is a type of Jesus Christ. Isaac carried the wood up the mountain. Christ carried the cross up the mountain. And someone says, well, where was God? God was right there with Jesus. When Jesus was going up that mountain, carrying that cross, God the Father was right there. Because the Bible says God was in Christ, reconciling the world back to himself. So this is a picture way back there on Mount Moriah. And we know that Abraham was going to go ahead and kill his son and offer him as a burnt offering. Now, a burnt offering is different than some other type of offerings. Many of the offerings, they would just put the lamb on the altar and they would cook it till it was pretty well done. And it was offered to the Lord, and then the priest would eat the lamb, okay? But a burnt offering, you burnt the meat, you burnt everything, you burnt it up completely, a complete sacrifice. And that's what Isaac was going to be. Now, I don't know how much Abraham really knew what was going on there, but it says that God was testing him and proving him. And if you've walked with God long enough, you will know that God will test you, especially on Sunday morning. You know, that night, oh, I love the Lord. Sunday morning comes, whew, man, this bed sure feels good. Can anybody testify to that? You know, as you get older now, some of you young folks don't know what I'm talking about, but when you get younger, you just don't jump out of that bed like you used to when you were young. I mean, you take one foot at a time, and you get it on the floor, and you get the other one, and you sit up on the side of the bed, and you say something like this, Susan, and you hear something like this, yes. Are you awake? Yes. Are you up on the side of the bed yet? No. Are you? I'm trying to. It's really funny. Okay, but anyway. So I know some of you just, you know, yeah, can't wait to get to church, I know. Anyway, but see, God tests us. God already knows what we're going to do. God knew what Abraham was going to do. But the testing is for us. And that way, when the enemy comes and tries to spill those lies into your mind. And you say, oh, buddy boy, let me tell you something. I've been tested so much in that area. Get out of here. You can't tempt me anymore. I have proven myself to God so many times. I won't grab that suggestion anymore. And you're able to have power over the devil because you've been tested. How many would buy a car or even a refrigerator and it hasn't been tested? Let me see. How many in here? You would buy a television, a refrigerator, or a car, and it never was tested. And you, has this been tested? And they say, no. And you would say, well, how do you know it runs? We don't know. How many would buy it? No. You would say, has this been tested? Oh, yes, it has been tested, and here's the guarantee. And they give you the guarantee when you buy it. So we are tested every day in our lives in many situations. And sometimes we fail the test, don't we? How many's ever failed the test? Yeah, That's why we got 1 John 1:9. But as you grow in the Lord, you grow to a point. It used to bother you maybe because you sinned. But as you grow in the Lord, it bothers you now that you displeased your Heavenly Father. Can you touch that? Can you touch that? I mean, do you understand what I'm saying there? That you don't want to do anything to hurt him. That type of relationship has developed. See, that's the way it is with husbands and wives. You don't want to do something because it would hurt my husband. Can we grab that? How many grabs that? Let me see. You're grand. Good. I'm very good. I just want to, because think it through now. Think it through. It's very important. So we see the story here. But this happened over there in Mount Moriah, over there on Mount Zion, and also on the third mountain there, Olive, Mount Olive. Now, I want to just share some things that happened on that mountain. It's amazing. Many things has happened in that mountain and in that particular geographical location over there in the past. But we're going to have some things in the near future that's going to happen in that geographical location over there. Okay? Let me just tell you something. The gospel went out from Mount Moriah. The gospel of Jesus Christ started right there. Remember, where's Jerusalem? On Mount Moriah. But it's also called Mount Zion. Now, we'll get into that later on a little bit. So the gospel, now just think about it. 2,000 years ago, and Jesus said, this gospel will go out to all the nations and the disciples and the church. We have that commission to spread this gospel around the world. Today, 2,000 years ago, closely 2,000 years, the gospel has gone out around the world and just about has touched every nation. That's pop. From that one geographic location, it started in Jerusalem. Isn't that amazing? And from there, it went all the way around the world, and now it's being preached all around the world to every nation. Powerful thought. From that one geographical location where Abraham offered his son, but also where God offered his son, because Abraham is a type of the Father, Isaac is a type of Jesus Christ. It's a picture that we see. But let's go on. So we see that Isaac was laid up on the altar, and Abraham was going to kill him, was going to cut his throat. They would take a knife, and when they sacrificed a lamb, they would tie the lamb and put him up on the wood, and they'd take a knife and cut his throat real quick, and he would start bleeding. We used to do hogs that way. If you ever killed hogs, you cut their throats real quick, and they bleed real quick and die real quick. And that's what he was going to do to his own son. Now, let's just stop for a moment. Abraham was a human being. Can you identify with Abraham? It's your son. It's your daughter. Who can that pick on? Linda, where's Linda? Linda, Linda, take your daughter, go up on a mountain and offer her as a burnt sacrifice. See if you can feel some emotion there. See if you can touch maybe what was going on into Abraham. But on the other hand, that's the human side of it. I want you to touch the spiritual side of Abraham. When God has told you to do something, he gives you the strength to do it. And it's like, in one way, there's no problem. I want you to grasp it. That's how powerful faith in the Spirit of God can be in your life when God tells you to do something that in the natural scare will scare you to death, but he comes on you and fills you, and you're able to do it with boldness, with confidence, and with power, no questions asked. I want you to grasp that, because if you can, you'll understand a little bit about when you walk in the Spirit. I mean, really walking in the power of the Spirit of God. I've had some experiences like that with God. You know, God told Susan and me to build a church, to buy some land. We didn't know where we were going to buy land. We looked for 9 months. All of a sudden, God came on me and told me, just get in the car and start driving. I said, Susan, God's talking to me. She dries her hands. We get in the car, and we drive all the way from Meadowcliff Avenue all the way around, back in those days, all the way down Foster Creek Road, not knowing where we were going. Stopped right out there, a for sale sign on a pine tree, and you could just see the telephone number. It was fading out. We took that phone number and we called, and God led us out here. We bought the land. And during that whole period of time, people say, you're crazy, you're nuts. But see, when the Spirit of God talks to you, you're a different person. Nobody around you are going to understand you. That's one of the reasons why Abraham did not tell Sarah, because she would not understand. See, when God talks to you, obeying is the easiest thing in the world. And people look at you and say, my goodness, Bob, Susan, you sold your house over there, came over here, and you did all this out here over the year. Every step we do in this ministry, I'm led by the Holy Spirit. People suggest things. I appreciate it. I thank you for your suggestion. But if God don't sanction it, we don't do it. So you learn that. Can anybody understand that? Do you understand that? So you're following God. You're not following your own desires and your own feelings and none of that. No, you are following the voice of God. When God said, when I was coming out here on my golf cart, just riding down the road right there, God spoke to me. Because Susan and me had touched a degree about killing that snake that bit Susan quite a few years back. All of a sudden, God says, go right across the lawn, Bob, and look for that snake. I obeyed just like that. I went right on there, and I came right up to that snake, and I killed it. On and on and on, and I'm not going that way, but I just want you to know that I've experienced those things, and I know some of you have, too, certain issues. But to understand Abraham, because over in Hebrews it said, Abraham had such faith that he knew even if he killed his son, God would raise him up. Over in the book of Hebrews. We don't have time to turn there. But that's a powerful thought as you read about these men and women of God. They were able to do it because the Spirit of God was in them or on them. And there's certain things we could never do unless God's Spirit is on us and in us and directing and moving us, okay? And as you mature in the Lord, you will learn to follow the voice of God. Because the Bible says in Hebrews that we are to hear the voice of God, and we can hear the voice of God. But you know, it don't make no sound. You don't hear it in the ear, but you know it inside of you, in your spirit, you hear it, but it's no sound to it. But you hear His voice, and you know His voice, and you hear it, but it makes no sound. But you hear His voice, and you know exactly what to do. All right. I remember Jacob, when Jacob was coming and he laid down. Remember, he put a stone for a pillar. Remember that? Jacob was there, and he went to sleep, and he had this dream or vision. He saw this ladder going from the earth to heaven, and angels coming up and down that ladder. How remembers that? Let's see. Okay, that's right at the spot, right there, where the temple was built. Right there on Mount Moriah, Mount Zion, right where he slept. That's where he had that vision, the angels going up and down. He said, this place is holy. God is in this place. So when you read that further on, we won't be able to get all the scriptures, but right there in that same spot where Jerusalem was built, Jacob had that vision of the ladder, angels going up and down, up and down, up and down in that same spot. And I'm slowly moving here because I want you to see that in the near future, the things that are going to happen in that same area. Okay, we're moving in a direction. Okay, later on, and I'll be teaching more on this later on, but later on, as you go through the Bible, you will see that David actually bought the site for 600 shekels. 600 shekels. He bought that same site where Abraham offered up Isaac in that area now, okay, and where Jacob had the vision of the ladder, and later on it was a threshing floor. This guy would thresh wheat, and David came and built an altar there to God, but he bought that area and gave 600 shekels. And of course, that's in the scriptures. I don't have time to turn there. That's in Second. Put Second Chronicles 3:1. We'll go ahead with that scripture then. Let's put that on the board because I got a lot I want to share. Second Chronicles 3:1. David bought the site, right there, that site. Can you hear me, Willie? Oh, it's up on the board. Thank you. Then Solomon began to build the house of the Lord at Jerusalem on Mount what? Moriah, where the Lord appeared to David, his father, in the place that David had appointed on the threshing floor of Ornan, the Jebusite. So you trace this all the way down in that particular area around there, and we're zeroing in. We can zero in on where Jerusalem is, plus all around that area, I would say 50 miles of diameter. So many things has happened to bring about our salvation today. It's powerful. So we see there, and then of course we know then later on, of course we know that Solomon built the temple. David couldn't do it. Now, what else happened? The temple was built. When it was built, when they dedicated the temple, the Shekinah glory, they say that the Shekinah glory is so thick, it's like a cloud. It is so thick, they say you can cut it with a knife. Now, that's a horrible way to say it. But the priest could not stand. The temple was filled with the Shekinah glory, and the priest could not stand to minister. And they had to actually get out of the way, out of the temple. Now, I say that to you because you need to see the tremendous manifestation of God. How many in here, if you have never felt the presence of God in a very strong way, I'm talking about a very strong way, you have literally felt that you could hardly stand. I have felt the power of God like that. How many has ever felt the power of God like that? Let me see your hands. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, boom, you're on the floor. You see, there's certain things we can't do in our power. But when the Shekinah glory, when God manifests himself, you'd be surprised the boldness that every one of you would have. You would go to a PTA meeting, and you would stand up, and you could preach. Are you listening? Are you ready for that? I've gone to PTA meetings, and I have preached at PTA meetings because they invited me as a minister, and I talked about Jesus, and they didn't invite me no more. So I just knocked the dust on my feet and just kept on going. See, you read the Bible and you wonder, how could these people do all of this? The Spirit of God. We are void without the Spirit of God. But when God anoints you to do something, you do it with all boldness and confidence, believe me. Now, the Shekinah glory filled the temple of God and stayed there until Israel went into captivity into Babylon and the Shekinah glory left the people of Israel. But that Shekinah glory is coming back, believe me, in the same place. All right, let's move on. What else happened on Mount Moriah? Christ was crucified on Mount Moriah. That's where he was crucified. We saw that Sunday in that DVD on Passion. Isn't it amazing when you look at things? It took 3 days for Abraham to get to Mount Moriah. And you see threes in the Bible, so many threes. You know, when in Deuteronomy, when Moses told the Israelite people to kill a lamb and to put blood on what? The lintel and the two doorposts? 1, 2, 3. How many crosses were they? 1, 2, 3. How long did it take Abraham to get to Mount Moriah? 1, 2, 3. 3 days. Man is Trinity. Spirit, soul, and body. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost. So you'll see three in the scriptures. Believe me, I got some of them written back there. I mean, pages on threes. All right, so Jesus was crucified on the cross where? Right there on Mount Olive, right there on Golgotha. They have different names for it. Golgotha on the mount. Now, the beautiful thing about it, he was crucified on Mount Olive, right there. And you can say Mount Moriah because it's three hills and it's all right in there, that particular area. But when Jesus ascended to heaven, what mount was Jesus on when he ascended to heaven? Mount Olive. Isn't that amazing? Where was the garden when Jesus was praying in the garden? Mount Olive, Gethsemane was right there in that particular place. So much was happening there. Now, we're talking about the past, but in the near future, we're going to talk about some things that is going to come about. But I want you to see the picture of so much has happened on those mounts. When Jesus comes back, you know where he's coming back? He's going to land right in the middle of Washington, D.C. Pittsburgh. No, He's going to land on Mount Olive, and it's going to split, and a big valley is going to open up, and that's going to save a lot of the Israelites to go through that valley to escape the Antichrist army. The last war during the tribulation years will be fought at Armageddon War, yeah, will be fought over there in that area. When they rebuild the temple, when the Jews are about to, you know, they're going to build that temple again. You know where it's going to be built? Same spot the other temples were. Mount Moriah, right there in that same spot, they're going to build the temple. That'll be the temple that the Antichrist will come in and declare himself to be God. So we see it's going to happen right there. When Jesus comes back and he lands on Mount Olive and it splits, he's going to walk right in through that eastern gate. You know, the eastern gate, they got it all cemented up, you know, with cement blocks. Have you ever seen the eastern gate? They got it all blocked in. The Muslims know that if Jesus comes back, he's going to land on Mount Olive and he's going to go through the eastern gate. So what they've done, they put those cement blocks and cemented it all in where he won't be able to go through. Isn't that amazing? He can come all the way from heaven, land on Mount Olive, it splits. But they're going to keep him out of Jerusalem because they've fixed it. And besides that, they buried all their dead people there. And he would not mess with no dead people. Let me tell you the news. He's coming down and he's going to go right through that eastern gate and really doesn't even have to bother a cement block because he's in his resurrected body. And if you read the scriptures, you find out the disciples, remember, they were in this room and the doors were locked and Jesus appeared in that room. He came right through the wall. And they said, how'd you get in here, Jesus? That's how you will be able to do. You'll be in your glorified. How many at night have really reached for your keys, especially when you had one kid on your this side and another kid on your back and you're trying to find your key and it's dark? You don't have to worry about that in our resurrected body. We just walk. We don't even have to go through the door. Just walk right through the wall in our glorified bodies. Believe me, Jesus will go in, and you know, he will rule the nations. He will rule the nations right there in that temple in Jerusalem, in that particular area there. Now, believe me, that temple will be sanctified, believe me, before he enters into it. When Satan comes in there, or the Antichrist, God knows how to clean the temple. It'll be clean. But he will rule the world. All the nations in the world, at that particular time, when Jesus returns, we're talking about the second coming of Christ now, when he lands on Mount Olive and he goes into Jerusalem in that spot, right on that mountain, that same mount where Isaac was offered, where Jesus was offered. So much has happened. Jesus will rule right there, the nations, and the nations will come, all the nations. Now, some of the nations, that when God judges the nations, you have what you call goat nations and you have sheep nations. And the goat nations, you know how you can tell a goat, but they butt you to death. But all of they will be judged and done away with. And the sheep nations will stay on the earth, but they will go to Jerusalem on that spot on Mount Olive, right there on Mount Moriah, Mount Zion, and worship the king. Now, will everybody in all the nations do it? Probably representatives, I would imagine. God will have to work that out. In my mind, I can't conceive everybody that is left on the planet that will go, but I'm sure they'll have representatives, or they could all go. I don't know. God will work that out. Now, Jesus gave the Beatitudes on the Mount. You remember the Beatitudes? It was on the Mount. He gave it to them. The Garden of Gethsemane was on the mountain. Palm Sunday started from the Mount, from Mount Olive, and went on into the temple. Now, as we see all of that, let me give you just a little bit of background on Abraham. It says in Genesis 22:18, for example, there is a prophecy that Abraham's seed or offspring, depending on the English translation, would become a blessing to people throughout the world. Now, I want us to stop and think for a moment. Now, all that I have shared, that one spot, God is going to bless all the nations of the world. And he has. He's blessed all the nations. Think about that for a moment. One spot from that one man, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, right on down the lineage to David, right on down, the seed came. So God has blessed the world from that one little spot over there. It's hard for us to conceive that in our minds, how from one little spot God can bless every nation. Let's read on. Because I want you to see something else here. It doesn't matter where we are at. We are out here. Here we are, just a small group of people. But did you know we're beginning to bless people in other nations? I want you to think about that now. Not building ourselves up, but I wanted to see how God works. God will take two fish and the bread and multiply it and feed the multitudes. If you have a people that are willing to obey him. Doesn't matter, we're out here. Who knows we're out here? Who cares we're out here? But do you see how far-reaching this body of believers is reaching into the world now that we have the internet now? See, the devil has fought this thing, and all I've done is prayed. I haven't said a whole lot about it. But there's a time when I want to jar your memory. I want you to see. It's taken us close to 3 years to get this thing moving and going. But we've just held steady. And now the messages that are preached from this little place out here in the sticks, the Gibbs family never knew that way back years ago. They're a part of reaching the world. These DVDs, Mike has, with his ministry now, is putting these things on the internet now, and people are listening to what we're preaching here in this little part of the woods. Hundreds of people now. I think it's up close to 2,000 people that have so far have, and we haven't even really gotten started shelling them out there yet. We've just had a few that we've put on there. And not just me, but all of our teachers reaching the world. I want you to see how God can take a little bit of oil. Just get you a whole bunch of pans and start pouring the oil in. Don't stop. Just get a whole lot of pans. See, God is a multiplication God. God is an increasing God. And when you can see the vastness that God can take just a little something, a couple of fish, a little bit of bread, feed you know, they say 5,000, but they had kids and they had the wives. So you're talking about 15 to 20,000 people from those little fishes. What is that you have in your hand, son? Just give it to the master. He'll feed the multitudes with it. You just have one message? Put it on the internet. He'll feed thousands. See, I want you to see something. We are there, and God is using every one of us in a vast way. Do you think Abraham understood that through his seed that the world would be blessed? How many of you think he really understood it? I don't think he did. He might have. I don't think he did. Because now we talk about his seed right on down the line. Till Jesus came, and that one seed. Now, some of the girls here are planting their garden. And they're expecting a harvest. And they just plant those little seeds in the ground. And they know if they keep it watered, the sunshine, and if the deer don't get there first, they will have some squash, okra, and other vittles, and can feed a lot of people out of that little garden. I want to say this. When we first started at the Shield, God had told me to build a pulpit. How would you like that? Bob built a pulpit. I built a pulpit. I put it in my front room. It stood there for about 6 months. Everybody looked at it. They didn't say nothing. And then one day God says, get your wife and two kids, go in there behind the pulpit and start preaching the gospel to them. Okay, so I went in there. My first congregation was Susan and my two daughters. My other daughter had been married and it was moved off. And I'm preaching behind the pulpit that I built to my two daughters and my wife. I didn't ask one person. I didn't ask one person. Alice Hernandez and her two young little daughters came first. They said, they came and we ministered to them and they said, well, where do you go to church? I said, well, right now we're meeting in the house. And she said, well, could we come? I said, if the Lord leads. So she started coming. And 1 year, God filled our front room and our dining room, which Susan had to get rid of her piano and all of her nice furniture and everything out. And we filled it up with chairs in my pulpit, and God filled it up with 70 people, and we never asked one person to come to our meetings. God, you just obey. You just follow God. I never started a ministry, never wanted a ministry. I'd hear brother just go fishing. But see, when God calls you, then God will begin to work. And I can tell you many, many, and I have shared a few things with some of you, but I could share many, many things that God has done over the years. But now, here's Abraham. See, God starts with a small thing here. Do you realize from Abraham and where we are today as far as the church, do you realize from Abraham on that mountain calling one man, and through his seed will become the Messiah, and now we see the world, millions and millions and millions of people have given their life to Christ. All came from that one seed, Jesus Christ. But it started in the natural from Abraham. And of course, Christ is a descendant of Abraham. So I want you to see something, how big God is and what he has done. And we are still a part of that multiplication. And one day God will reward every one of us for our faithfulness. God never calls us to be successful. This is where people mess up. Oh, I got to be successful. No, you don't. You just need to be obedient. Listen to me now. You know the parable about the faithful servant. Thy good, what? And faithful servant. Faithfulness. Persevering. Persistent. Faithfulness. I've had people come and go. I'm not mad at nobody. I love them all. I poured my life out for them all, and I'll do that until God calls me home. I ain't mad at nobody, ain't going to get mad at nobody, ain't got no axe to grind. I'm free. I know how to stay free. You go to the throne. We talked about that tonight. And cast all your cares upon the Lord. I'm going to say one more thing here. Sometimes you'll see things that you don't like. Welcome to humanity and reality. But don't let that move you. There's always things, and even in your own life right now, you probably don't like. And you can't do nothing about it. And that's why we have that prayer over there. I don't know how many of you have ever read it. It was given to Susan and me. We donated it to the church. God grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change that which I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. There's just a lot of things that sometimes we just have to endure. Somebody say endure. I don't like that word, but I've lived long enough, because the Bible talks about endure hardships as a good soldier. But you got to look beyond the cross. We saw this film Sunday. You know what was in Jesus' mind? I know there was quite a few things, I'm sure, but he looked beyond the cross. Beyond this moment of suffering, he saw the glory. See, once you see the glory, everything down here is dull. Can I say a word in church? It's dunk. Bob, you shouldn't say that in church. But that's what Paul called it. We don't have to go into all that he was, the Pharisees of Pharisees. He says, it's all dunk. Once you understand and comprehend the glory, the Father, to behold the God that created all things, you are in a different plateau of life. And until you see that, you'll just always be struggling and moaning and groaning. You got to see the glory. I'm not talking about with the physical eyes, in the spirit. Oh yeah, you can see in the spirit. Remember Elijah? His servant got up one morning, went outside, stretching. He looked, he saw thousands of horses and men, armies, vast army of the Syrians just surrounding him and his master. He runs in. He says, Master, we're surrounded. And the prophet said, Lord, open his eyes that he might see that there's more with us than them. And the servant went out, and his eyes were open, and he saw all of these mighty chariots of fire of God. And those other folks looked about like that. How many of you know there's more with us than them? So you got to see that. You got to know that. You got to believe that. You got to accept that. You got to receive that. That will cause you to stand when everything goes to nothing. You know whom you have believed in, and you are persuaded that he's able to keep that which he has committed to you. That's where the strength comes in. Behold, the Lamb of God. Behold, I see the glory. Now, I don't have to get rough, but I see this is so important. That once we can break out of that plateau of human efforts and flesh and touch the face of God in the Spirit, everything down here I I cry sometimes when I see couples fighting over nothing. It was his fault. No, it was his fault. Oh, my children, my children, my children. Step out of that arena, out of that rim of the natural, and step in the rim of faith and in the spirit. Fighting over nothing is all going to perish. Everything you own, phew, what you don't spend, your kids will spend it. Write that down. I will say one more thing there. And it's good to leave something for the children, and I want to do it. This one daughter, she was about 50 years old. Her mother's about 75 or 80 years old. And, Mom, you know, you don't need to buy that for so-and-so. And she said, daughter, it's my money. I love it. In love, of course. And I'll spend it like I want to. Now, I don't know. Some of you can touch that. You understand what I'm talking about. When you get older, the kids begin to reach for the pocketbook, you know. Well, it's only natural, you know. They want to look out for you, you know. Okay, let's move on here. In other words, God is making a promise, a covenant to Abraham, telling him that there is something special about his bloodline and that it would have a worldwide impact. All the nations of the earth will be blessed by one man, Abraham. But you got to see the seed going down. This covenant is handed down later from Abraham to his son Isaac. That's in, you don't have to turn that, we don't have the time, but it's in Genesis 17, 18, and 20, and then in Genesis 21, 12, and then to Abraham's grandson, Jacob, which is in Genesis 28, 14. Later in the Bible, we see echoes of this promise being made to other descendants of Abraham through his grandson, Jacob, including Judah, Jesse, who was David's father, and then to David. So, when God makes a covenant, he keeps his covenant. Now, it's so important to see that. Now, I'm going to run through this, and there's so much I have to share. All right, Mount Moriah is the name of the elongated north side stretch of land lying between Kidron Valley and Hagar Valley, between Mount Zion to the west and the Mount of Olives to the east. So they're all right there, pretty, you know, close together. The northern area of the mountain summit lays desolate for long after Zion captured by David. It was, in fact, still the private property of the Jebusite king. And it goes on and says, in the course of in the course of time, the mountain had acquired an aura of sanctity, and he's the subject of many traditions. And it goes on and says that God led, of course, Abraham to that mountain, and from that mountain we see many things started. Okay, now we know in the future Christ is coming back, and he's going to be ruling on that mountain. Let me just say a few things about Mount Olive real quick. Like, the Mount of Olive is located on the east side of Jerusalem. It is one of the most reverent places for Christians. The view of Jerusalem from the mount is one of the most spectacular scenes in the world. On its slopes are the Garden of Gethsemane, Bethany, that was a little town there, It was on the Mount of Olives where Jesus sometimes taught his disciples, where he began his Palm Sunday entrance into Jerusalem, where he prayed and sweated great drops of blood when he was in the garden, where he was arrested and where he rose up to heaven. And Zechariah 14 indicates that this is where the Messiah, Jesus, will be when he returns, that his feet will touch the mount and that it will split into two from east to west, allowing the people of Jerusalem to escape a battle that will be raging in Jerusalem. And of course, there's many Jewish cemeteries on the mount now, and it goes back to 2,000 years. That's just on Mount Olive. Now, talk about Mount Zion now. Here's Mount Zion. All right, what is Zion? What is Mount Zion? What is the biblical meaning of Zion? Answer, Psalms 87:2-7. You don't have to turn there. Put that on the board, Psalms 87, 2 and 3. Psalms says, the Lord loves the gates of Zion more than all the dwelling of Jacob. He'll get it on there directly. O city of God, occurring over 150 times in the Bible, the word Zion essentially means fornication. Not fornication, but fortification, a fort. Occasion. In the Bible, Zion is both the city of David and the city of God. Okay, Mount Zion. Don't laugh back there. As the Bible progresses, the word Zion transitioned from referring primarily to a physical city to having a more spiritual meaning. The first mention of the word Zion in the Bible in 2nd, did you ever get up there on that one? Yeah, there it is. The Lord loves the gates of Zion, through which the crowd of pilgrims enter from all nations more than all the dwelling of Jacob, okay, of Israel. All right, thank you. Okay, I'm trying to go fast here. Nevertheless, David captured the fortress of Zion, the city of David. Zion, therefore, was originally the name of the ancient Judahized fortress in the city of Jerusalem. After David captured the stronghold of Zion, Zion was then called the city of David. And I have all the scriptures, but we don't have time to turn there. When Solomon built the temple in Jerusalem, Zion expanded in meaning to include the temple and the area surrounding it. Zion was eventually used as a name for the city of Jerusalem, the land of Judah, and the people of Israel as a whole. I got plenty of scriptures on that. The most important use of the word Zion is in a theological sense. Zion is used figuratively of Israel as the people of God. The spiritual meaning of Zion is continued in the New Testament, where it is given the Christian meaning of God's spiritual kingdom, the heavenly Jerusalem. And you find that in Hebrews 12:22 and Revelation 14:1. Peter referred to Christ as the cornerstone of Zion. See, I lay a stone in Zion, a chosen and precious cornerstone, and the one who trusts in him will never be put ashamed. Now, let's get our minds to a few things in the future here, because we know that Christ is coming back on his second coming. Now, remember, the rapture is all in the sky. He comes, he doesn't land on the earth during the rapture. He's up there. We go up to meet the Lord in the air. But in the second coming, he comes and lands on Mount Olive and splits that mountain, okay? So you see the difference there, okay? One, the rapture, we go up with him. On the second coming, we come back with him. You'll see that in Revelation chapter 19. But it's all going to happen right over there as we study the scriptures, and I just touched just a little bit of it tonight to give you an idea that what is happening over there right now, things are lining up over there, and there'll be another war over there real soon. It may even be this year. Believe me, it's happening right over there. Everything will be done right over there. And it's amazing that the Antichrist will try to capture that area over there themselves. Isn't that amazing? That's the devil through the Antichrist will try to capture. So keep your eye on Jerusalem. Keep your eye on the Jewish people, because what is happening in the world, all of the things as we look at history now, we can look back over all these this period of time and see it all happened right over in that particular area. But it has touched the other parts of the world too. So right over there, the Garden of Eden, everything was right over there, around the Mediterranean over there, the Mediterranean Sea over there. All of that, as you study history, Rome, all those nations, Babylon, Persia, Rome, all those different kingdoms, all of those kingdoms will one day become the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ. There'll be one kingdom when it's all over, and that'll be the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ. And those that have put their faith in him will rule and reign with him during the millennium years and throughout eternity. So, you know, it's an honor to serve God. It's an honor to serve the Lord Jesus Christ. Sometimes you get tired, and that's the human element in all of us. But always remember, it's a great honor to serve the Lord Jesus Christ. And when you see what he did for us Sunday on that film, I consider it a great honor to do whatever he wants me to do. Because this little bit of time we have down here, it is so short. And the older you get, the more you'll realize it. If you live to be 80 years, it's just a little blimp on the radar. That's all it is. Let's pray. Father, we just want to thank you now for a little bit better understanding of how you take a geographical location and touch the world. You take just a few people and touch the world. And you've included us in that. And we want to thank you for choosing us before the foundation of the world to be your children. Holy Spirit, have your way in our lives throughout the remaining time we have on this earth. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.